আসসালামু আলাইকুম, আই এম শেখ ফারজানা সীমা, অ্যাসিস্ট্যান্ট প্রফেসর অফ ইংলিশ, ঢাকা কলেজ, ঢাকা। হাউ আর ইউ মাই ডিয়ার স্টুডেন্টস? হোপফুলি ইউ আর ফাইন। অ্যাজ উই আর পাসিং থ্রু এ ক্রুশিয়াল টাইম, উই হ্যাভ টু বি কেয়ারফুল। সো মাই ডিয়ার স্টুডেন্টস, স্টে অ্যাট হোম, স্টে সেফ অ্যান্ড স্টে হেলদি। টুডে আই এম গোয়িং টু কন্ডাক্ট এ ক্লাস ফর অনার্স ফার্স্ট ইয়ার স্টুডেন্টস অ্যান্ড মাই কোর্স টাইটেল ইজ ইন্ট্রোডাকশন টু পোয়েট্রি and course code is 103 and my topic is Ode to Skylar by Percy Bysshe Shelley. My dear students, at first I will tell you something about the poet. Percy Bysshe Shelley was born on 4 August 1792, who was one of the major English romantic poets and philosophical poets as well. He was the eldest son of Timothy Shelley, a wealthy land owner. So he belonged to aristocratic family. In 1804, he went to Eton School. After finishing his schooling, he went to Oxford University in 1810, where he met Thomas Jefferson Hook, with whom he developed a warm and intimate friendship. By the influence of Thomas Jefferson Hook, Shelley became skeptic and agnostic. Agnostic means the person doesn't believe in God. This religious skepticism led them to publish a pamphlet entitled The Necessity of Atheism, 1811. After publishing this pamphlet, both of them were expelled from the Oxford University. On July 8, 1822, Shelley went on a boating excursion and caught on a storm and was drowned. So he died in 1822. Shelley did not see fame during his lifetime, but recognition of his achievement in poetry grew steadily following his death. That means he became popular after his death. His great works are Ozymandias, Ode to the West Wind, and Ode to Skylar, and many more. Shelley belongs to Romantic Age. The duration of Romantic Age is 1798 to 1832. And as he belongs to Romantic Age, and Romantic Age has some particular characteristics. Now, my dear students, I will tell the particular characteristics of Romantic Age. Number one, subjectivity. Next one, high imagination. Then supernaturalism. And then revolutionary zeal, love for nature and spontaneity. These are the characteristics of Romantic Age. Now, my dear students, I will describe about these characteristics, but very briefly. First one is subjectivity. All romantic literature is subjective. The poet does not care for rules and regulation, but gives free expression of his emotion. The poet expresses himself. That means the poet expresses his personal feelings and emotion and what he believes. That means in this subjectivity, I can give an example. That is Ozymandias by Percy Bysshe Shelley. I think all of you went through Ozymandias. In this poem, Percy Bysshe Shelley told that nothing is permanent in this world. And Keats is another romantic poet. He told in his another poem, he told that art is permanent in this world. So both of them express their own feelings. So that is called subjectivity. Next one is high imagination. The poet goes far away from real world into a fantastic kingdom of high imagination. That means the poet creates a imaginative world and he uses his imagination in his poem. That is called high imagination. Next one is supernaturalism. Romantic poet use wonder, mystery, and beauty of universe. They feel the presence of unseen power in nature. They are attracted by the stories of fairies, ghosts, and witchcraft. That means in a supernatural element, supernaturalism, we find the presence of fairies and ghosts and witchcraft in the story. Next one is revolutionary zeal. That means the poets protest against the existing order of the society, such as they protest against the corruption of the society. That is called revolutionary zeal. Next one is love for nature. Romantic poets shows the beauty of the nature. Romantic poets carry us from the suffocating atmosphere of the cities into fresh environment. Next one is spontaneity. Romantic poetry is spontaneous overflow of powerful passion. The poet does not care for the perfection of form or clarity of expression. That means lack of artificiality. Romantic poets write from their heart. That is called lack of artificiality. So these are the characteristics of romantic age. Now, my dear students, Ode to a Skylark is an ode. Now I will describe and explain what is an ode. Ode is a lyrical poem that begins with an address to someone expressing grief or agony but ends with consolation. It deals with a serious theme. That means ode is a kind of a lyric. It opens with an address to someone or something. It middle part develops a sense of grief. It ends with some sort of consolation. Its subject is serious and its tone is grave or sad. So these are the characteristics of an ode. Now, my dear students, I will tell you particular theme of this poem. The music. The music of the Skylark has been idealized by Shelley. The poet wants to know what is it that inspires the Skylark to sing such a melodious song. The poet again also contrasts the sorrow and suffering of mankind with joy of the Skylark. My dear students, in this poem, the poet uses series of similes. Simile is a clear comparison between two things. Every writer and poet has his own style to convey his message to his readers. In this case, some poet or writer uses a myth, legend, symbolism, metaphor, and Shelley uses similes. So in this poem you will find series of similes. Now, my dear students, I will describe about the poem or summary of the poem. The poet calls the Skylark a cheerful and happy spirit. The Skylark is not a bird but a spirit, because flying at a great height, it is not visible. The Skylark sings spontaneous song from somewhere near the sky. The Skylark sings effortlessly and without any previous preparation. The Skylark symbolizes high imagination, eternal happiness, and harbinger of peace and progress. It is a spirit as it is unseen. The Skylark's sweet tones and note an ideal message spread everywhere in the atmosphere. It is heard by the poet, who is highly impressed. He boldly claimed that the Skylark is a superior thing in the sky. The cloud, the stars, the moon, the sun, all are left behind, and the Skylark dominates by the excellence and tuned soothing voice. The poet himself does not know what the Skylark actually is. The mystery of the Skylark is still unsolved to the poet, but he is sure of the fact that he can learn a message of welfare from it and can spread in the whole world for the recreation of of the society. He compares the beauty and sweetness of the skylark to a highly born beautiful girl who gives in the tower and sings sweet a love song. The girl is herself is not visible to outsider because he is confined in the tower. The skylark too is invisible to our eyes, but the sweet music of the skylark is audible to us. Similarly, skylark is compared with the golden glowworms. The glowworms itself is invisible because it is hidden by the grass and leaves of plants, but we can recognize the glowworms by the light that is scatters around itself. In the same way, we cannot see the skylark because it flies upper part of the sky, but we can hear the music of the skylark. The music of the skylark is compared to rain showers which revive the grass and flowers. These are joyous and clear and fresh, but the music of the skylark suppresses them all. That means the music of the skylark is more fresh and pure than the rain shower. The poet says that even the rainbow cloud do not spread as bright drops as the presence of the skylark spread a rain of melody. In short, the music of the skylark suppresses every pleasure of nature. In this poem, the life of human being is full of disappointment and frustration. Human beings have desire and longings which remains unfulfilled. Where they look back of their past or look forward their future, they feel an intense desire for what they have not been able to achieve. The sweetest song of human beings are those that are full of sorrow and grief. The song of the skylark, on the contrary, are an expression of pure joy. The skylark is not troubled by the death as mankind is. Its clear understanding of death. A human being cannot become happy because of their such feeling of hate, fear, and pride, and they do not have fellow feeling. They have lack of fellow feeling. If the skylark could communicate to Shelley even half of its joy, Shelley would feel inspired to write poems that would compared with the song of the skylark. The world would listen attentively to Shelley's poem, just as Shelley is now listening to the song of skylark. The poet wishes to get instruction and message from skylark, so he asks it to teach him a sweet thought. In this poem, Shelley uses a series of similes. I already told you, my dear students, similes is a clear comparison between two things. Every poet or writer has his own style to convey his message to his readers. In this case, Shelley uses similes to convey his message to his readers. The music has been idealized by Shelley, and Shelley contrasts the sorrow and suffering of mankind with sweet music and joy of skylark. Skylark is a joyous bird, but human life is full of suffering because human being cannot have the quality to become happy, and they have lack of fellow feeling. And discrimination of the society and economical slavery and exploitation, because of all these reasons, human being cannot become happy. Finally, Shelley wants to share half of skylark joy, then he would feel inspired to write poems. The whole world then listen attentively to Shelley's poem, just as Shelley is now listening to the song of skylark. Shelley wants to create a new generation of mankind who can enjoy liberty, equality, and fraternity. The poet wants to create a new society where all men will be equal and where all men will enjoy freedom, peace, and love, and all people will have fellow feeling. Shelley, being one of the greatest romantic poets, was an uncompromising rebel. He continued his struggle for the cause of individual liberty, social justice, and peace, and he wishes to bring social reformation by his inspiring and courageous work of literature. That's all for today, my dear students. Stay home, stay safe, stay healthy. Thank you.